your time for the fulfillment of purpose. It's your time for abundance and prosperity, because with God, all things are possible. Join Pastor Lekan Wellington Adegunwa, a dynamic preacher and teacher of the Word of God, as he ministers with clarity and power. Pastor Lekan is a coach, an international conference speaker, who teaches that God wants us blessed and prosperous in every area of our lives. 10 a.m. every Sunday, TRM Church Preston, 213-217 Lancaster Road, North Preston, PR12PY. 2 p.m. every Sunday, TRM Church, Manchester, Emmanuel Center, 174 Langworthy Road,
Salford,
Manchester, M6, 5 p.m. At TRM Church, we are committed to your fulfillment in life. We are expecting you.
Friend, he said, which of you shall have a friend and go to him at midnight and say to him, friend, lend me 3 loaves. Continue. For a friend of mine has come to me on his journey, and I have nothing to set before him. Which of you will have this kind of friend? Verse 7. And he will answer from within and say, which of you will have a friend that you have gone to meet in the middle of the night? That I have this friend that has just traveled from Australia, and I don't have food to give him, and he is hungry. And then that your friend will stay inside his room and be answering you while you are in the cold in winter, minus 30. And say, and answer you from within and say, do not trouble me. Which one of you will have that kind of friend? I'm teaching you about correct scripture now. This is, everybody say, this is proper Bible study. I just want to scatter some theology of the things you have been told, which is a lie. So all those things you have been taught about the importunity woman, I want to destroy it now. That's what I want to do. I want to destroy that theory. It's not in the Bible. It's fake. It's not true. And that's where I'm going. So get ready. This is theology class. Which one of you? You see, when you read Bible, don't translate with your mind. Read what is written. And they say, do not trouble me. The door is now shut. And my children are with me in bed. I cannot rise and give it to you. In verse 5, which one of you will have this kind of friend? Verse 8, I say to you, look at Jesus. Everybody see Jesus talking. You know this is Jesus talking. I say to you, though he will not rise and give to him because he is his friend. The man came to him as a friend. He refused as a friend, but then he stood up not as a friend. He stood up because of his persistence and rise to give him as many as he needs. Verse 9. So I say to you, ask, and it will begin to you, seek, and you find, knock, and drink. Let me explain to you what it means. Jesus Christ is saying something here. You see, we make Christianity difficult. What Jesus is saying is, which one of you will have a friend that you will come to at midnight and knock his door that I need something, and then he will stay in his room and be shouting, don't trouble me, I don't have time, I'm on my bed with my person. And only until the person now stayed and pressed the bell, pressed the bell, pressed the bell, the friend now say, idiot, just take, this is everything you want. That's what happened in that story. The Bible say he did not give him as a friend. And Jesus said, I am not like that. That scripture is not telling you what God is. It's telling you what God is not. And that's some of the theology they have told us. Importunity woman, oh God, bless me, bless me, bless me, bless me. Fake. He's saying God is not like that, that you have to pester him before he blesses you. God is not like that, that you have to bang the door and then he will answer you, Kali Bradosha, not because he's your friend, but because you are bothering him. That's what that scripture is saying. He said he will arise not as his friend, but lest he kills him with his continuous coming. Then he answered, that's not the God you serve. That's, let me now give you this. That is how the heathen do. That's what Jesus was telling them. God doesn't do like that. Listen to this. I remember when I was somewhere in near Egbadu area. I can't forget. But let me tell you what happened. This is in Nigeria. Let me tell you what happened. I was in a place that people who were serving Shango were trying to invoke the spirit of Jonko. This is not the one I read in the Bible. I saw it. And then they were praying. You know, they are praying. They were doing incantation. And they were doing it. They were cutting themselves. Blood was flowing. waiting for answer to happen, waiting for some things to happen, and they were cutting, expecting things to happen, because that is the kind of God they serve. That's what you read in your Bible when the man of God says, let's put water down and see the God that answers by fire. He is God. And then the Bible said they spent the night overnight trying to invoke their God. Malika Shanda Korea. When the man of God wanted to do so, did he spend days?
No.
To invoke his God? Because that God is slow to hearing and deaf. Because some of those things that we've been taught, that God is a deaf God, that you need to put wool out of his ears. And that's why we don't thank God. For if you understand what Jesus is saying, you will spend 90% of your prayer giving him thanks for what he has done for you. Not pestering God. And that's why when you come to pray, 90% of your prayer is, God, do for me, give me, do. Listen to this. Look at some third person, God is not deaf. God is not deaf. Believe me. God is not deaf. God is not deaf. I know somebody is saying, but what does it mean that you should pray always? He didn't say pray always by picking one prayer point and praying all the days of your life. He didn't say pray always and forget the souls that are not saved. He didn't say pray always and not thank him. He didn't say pray always and not praise him. He didn't say pray always and not remember other people. He didn't say pray always and not intercede. We have converted pray always to requesting our own personal need all the time. For God is deaf. Listen, you know why I've told you this? God loves you. Before you speak, he heard. Listen, learn patience and perseverance. When you speak, God heard. The fact that you want to break the door does not make any difference. He said knock. He didn't say scatter the door. No, he didn't say that. He didn't say destroy the door. I don't know. He said, knock, kaka. It's okay. It's okay. Hey, look at some dead person. It's okay. Third person is not deaf. Because once you understand that kaka is okay, then what do you do after kaka? And then when you are waiting, what do? You thank God. You see, that's why you don't thank God. If we say pray now, if we say let us pray concerning God should give us a car for 1 hour. Some of you will request that car for solid 1 hour. Oh God, give me a car. Car. Give me a car, oh Lord. Car. Oh Lord, car. Oh Lord, Father, car. Oh my God, Father, car. But if you understand this, all you are going to say, Father, I thank you, for you have made all things available unto me. Can you see the difference? Can you see the difference? Lord, I know that before I ask, you have already answered. Lord, I thank you. You see, before you know, you are already thanking God for the car, and then it's after 40 minutes, you now remember that you have not even asked for the car. You now say, therefore, oh Lord, I thank you because I have received the car. And then once you said that, you before you know, you move on again. I say, so Lord, I give you praise. For the... That's prayer. Look at some dead person, that's prayer. You will even pray longer. You know why you get tired? Because by saying, say, ka, 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 ka. Even your brain will not begin to say, ka, ka, ka. Your brain is knocked out. You are tired. But if you have what to say of his goodness and his love and his mercy, do you understand what God is saying is, I am not like that. You don't break the door before I answer you. That's why people get frustrated. And that's what they say. No, it's because you are not praying enough. You are not praying enough. I have seen people who have prayed enough. You see, people are deceiving you because they can't tell you the truth. They say you have not prayed enough. That's why you have a problem. It's not true. There are people who have not prayed at all. God answered them. So how can it be because you have not prayed enough? That's why. Prayer is good. Everyone say prayer is necessary. But prayer is not God. Prayer is essential. Let me tell you why prayer is essential. Prayer, listen to this. Let me just tell you one definition of prayer. You know, prayer is communication with God. You know that one. Prayer is also an avenue to cause the divine God to intervene in humanity. And then he gives you that permission to do that. So when God is saying, I don't want to encroach. You remember when he said in the Revelation, he said, I stand by the door and I knock. it that let me in. So the will and the power is what you exercise in prayer. To say, God, you are not encroaching. I am okay for you to take over. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? So prayer is essential. Look at someone, tell the person, you need to pray at all times. But you need to understand what prayer is. Your God is not a deaf God. He's not a wicked God who will leave you in the cold. And then after screaming and screaming, he will now come not as a friend, but just so that you don't kill him. Jesus said, which of you will have that kind of friend? Which of you will? Okay, I want an answer. Which of you will have that kind of friend? Answer. Which of you will have that kind of friend? Nobody. Okay, so how come you now think Jesus is trying to say that is who he is? What an indictment. You cannot have that kind of friend, but you have the audacity to think that Jesus is like that. It's not fair now. Look at your friend. Every person, it's not fair. How can you say you can't have a wicked friend that you have to stay by the door and knock? Rain will beat you, everything we do. And we will not even say, just come in first. And we enter from within. Did you not read your Bible? An answer from within. And then we have been taught in church, Jesus is saying that's how it should be. That it's like that. That when we stay and knock, that's when he will answer us. What a disgrace. Can you see that theology, that indoctrination can kill people? But because God still answers, we continue in ignorance. But you know why God still answers? Because your ignorance cannot necessarily stop God. Because he loves you so much, he just laughs. I don't know why this, my son, is just stupid. But he needs bread. Let's give him bread. But it's better for you to think rightly and see a good God. Don't see a wicked God. Look at somebody, tell the person, God is not wicked. Can I cause more trouble? If you want deliverance, Brother George, if you want deliverance, you must fast for 40 days. If not, you can't have deliverance. What kind of rubbish is that? Where in the Bible is it written? Even the woman that the person that had legions of demons, is it the person that have demons that needs to go and fast? Or the person that needs to cast out the demon? For if you read your Bible, it's not the person who has the problem. It's the person who wants to be empowered to deal with it. But because they're not sure whether the result will happen, they shift it on you. So that they will tell you that because you did not fast enough. That's why you didn't have a problem. You didn't have an answer. See. Do you like that you're in church today? It's deception. It's all gimmick. It's playing on your mind. It's putting the responsibility on you. It's making you feel bad for yourself. It's making you think you have not prayed enough, you have not fasted enough. That's why your story have not changed. It's not true. People who didn't fast like you, God answered their prayer. All right? Look at somebody, tell the person, God is good. Don't let people make you run helter-skelter and shift your focus from God. There's something that is called waiting. There's something that is called perseverance. In order to eradicate waiting and perseverance, we create a lot of gimmicks. And make people think, right now, the God of suddenly. No, you don't know the meaning of suddenly. Because if you know the meaning of suddenly, you will read your Bible that Paul and Silas have worked with God for long. Number one. Number two, they prayed, they sang throughout the midnight, and then the prisoners had them. So tell me the definition of suddenly. The definition of suddenly was that when the answer came, they were not particularly expecting it at the time. They continued with what they were doing, and then something happens. That's the definition. Are you learning something? You know what I want you to learn? I'll tell you what I want you to learn. I want you to just learn that God is good. There's something that my mother used to say, along with Roro. Ha, my God. The meaning is that God is not, I don't even know how to even say it. Who can help me? God is not wicked, full of bitterness, who is trying to get you. Who's trying to see? I want to see how much you can pray now before I answer your prayer. God doesn't think like that. You think God doesn't have work to do? God is waiting. In the whole of heaven, why the angels are singing, holy, 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 holy. Why the angels are praising him, the only thing he's thinking is how to show you. Just look at that. So you now think that God of heaven will stoop low and begin to dislike somebody because you don't like them. Look at somebody, tell the person, God is good. Tell the person, when I pray, he hears. Tell someone, he's not deaf. He hears. Please learn to give thanksgiving. Learn to thank him. What is the title of my message today? I don't even know, because this is not what I wanted to preach. God is good, and he answers prayers. Look at someone, tell the person, God is good, and he answers prayers. So we might as well stay on it so that we can close, because if I go to what I want to preach today, then you are stuck. All right. Say, Pastor, don't go there. Are you the Holy Spirit? Amen. Amen. Praise God. God is good. God is good. God is good. Look at that scripture. I say to you, ask. 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 And it will be given to you. Is my God not good? And seek, you will find. Knock, it will be open. I have a good news for you. Your prayers, God heard all of them. Amen. He did. He did. I might not be able to see it today, but he did. He did. Because people don't want to be patient. That's why they do it. No, listen. He did. Because once you are desperate, you the devil, you will open the door for Satan. He did. He did. He did. He did. Follow your God with all of your heart. Trust him, believe him, depend on him. He is a good God. It's not a bad God. He doesn't like evil, but you are not the evil. So what God tries to do is to sieve the evil out, remove the surgery. Look at some television, God is a surgeon. That's what God is trying to do. Remove, cut the evil out. You are not the evil. God, listen to this. God likes you, loves you, wants the best for you. And you must understand that God is good. Because once you know that God is good, the way you deal with him is different. If you have a good friend, what do? You become good. He that wants friends should do what? Makes himself friendly. If God is good to you, won't you be good to God? If you know that God is really, really good to you, you will be good to him. If you know that God is watching out for you, if you know that God is always there for you, he hears when you pray. And not just that he hears, he answers. I don't know what people have told you. There is therefore now no condemnation. Some people read many kind of Bible. I don't know where they manufacture the Bible from. But there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set us free from the law of sin and death. God is so good to you. God is so good to you. And let me tell you, the best way to live a good life is to know that your God is good. Then that will begin to adjust your mindset. Begin to adjust the things you think about. You know that this God is good. I don't want to displease him. This God is good. I don't want to be like this. I know he's good to me. He is good to me. He is good to me. Look at some third person. God is good to you. And also, let your prayers be full of what? Thanksgiving. Is this Psalm 100? I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. Amen. Let me tell you one thing I want you to change. From today, every time you want to pray, Think for a minute before you pray. Don't open your mouth and begin to attack God. And begin to attack God with your prayers. Begin to attack Him. There's no need to ask God. God, what have I done wrong? No, it's not by shouting. If you've done something wrong, don't say, God, I am sorry. I have messed this up. Don't ask God what you have done wrong. No, it's not by shouting. If you've done something wrong, don't say, God, I am sorry. I have messed this up. Don't ask God what you have done wrong. Don't be like Cain. Am I my brother's keeper? God, what did I do? No, you didn't do anything. It is not God. You need to ask yourself, what did I do? Be full of thanksgiving. Be full of thanksgiving. Let me say this. I said it on Friday and I want you to know. God is not the one causing trouble for you. I repeat. He is a good God. The Bible says every good and perfect gift. Every good and perfect gift come from God, the Father of lights, in whom there is no variableness, neither the shadow of eternity. Let me tell you what it means. What he's saying is, he's not going to change. From every good thing comes from God. Every good thing comes from in whom there is no variableness. In other words, he's not going to change his mind tomorrow. He's not going to say, you know what, you know what, you know what, you know what, you know what. Is it this thing you have done, James? I'm going to change for a minute. I'm just going to bring some evil to you and going to deal with you. No, in whom there is no variableness, neither the shadow of a turning. God is good. He is good. When you ask, He hears. Learn to thank Him. Learn to. There was a time I was telling us about the past tense, praying in the past tense. It's all about thanksgiving. That's what Job did. Jonah. That's what Jonah did. He said, I have prayed to the Lord. And even David did the same. I cried unto the Lord and He answered me. Because He's a faithful God. He is good. God answers prayer. He's the God that answers prayer. Unto Him shall all flesh come. Look at you. Tell the person, God loves you so much. Tell the person, God loves you so much. He answers your prayers. He answers your prayers. He will do everything for you. He loves you. And because He loves you, He answers your prayers. And before I just finish it, let me just tell you this. You know, sometimes we're thinking, okay, God, why is it that things just happen to us and this and that and I don't know that, la, 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 la. Let me tell you this. There are consequences when you do things wrong. I was explaining this, I think, on Friday night. There are consequences when you do things wrong, and it doesn't mean God doesn't love you. There are consequences. If you love your child, and then you've just bought them, let's say, a TV to put in their room, and then it's on the table, and then while they were messing about, the TV fell on their leg. Do you still love your child? Yes. Is it going to be painful? Are you going to go to the hospital to sort the leg out? Yes. Can you do something? Can you automatically do something about the pain? Are they going to feel the pain? Yes. Do you love them? So why the pain? The consequences of allowing, of messing about and allowing that thing to fall on his leg. Full stop. Children, do you understand what I'm talking about? Mom loves you, dad loves you, mess about, that's it. If you say, no, he don't hurt, you'll find that it will. Amen. So with God, there are consequences. It's not because God doesn't love us. So don't let somebody tell you, no, because of that thing you have done, God has turned His back on you. God, what do you think God is? God is somebody who doesn't have work to do, is turning around. So when He turns His back on you, then He must be turning His face on somebody else. And when He's turning His face on you, then His back is on somebody else. Listen to this. God is not like that. And that's why I want you to know the truth. Don't use your will against your own life. Because when you make decisions that are contrary to the word of God, it will create things you don't like. That's all it is. It's not God trying to mess you up. No, God will never, 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 think about it. Spend time on it. God will never in any way try to mess you up. But when you make decisions against the word of God, you walk yourself into trouble. Even while you are in trouble, God still loves you with everlasting love, and his grace is still sufficient for you. But just that a TV fell on your leg, you're going to feel the pain. God loves you. You keep on smoking, you mess your lung up, and you get cancer, you're going to die of cancer. God still loves you, and his grace is sufficient. But you know what? You didn't make use of it. I wanted to settle within yourself that he's a good God. And if you settle within yourself he's a good God, you're going to settle within yourself to be good. Because your God is good. You're going to make up your mind that you want to be good because your God is good. Amen. You want to be good. How many people know that the best way to pay goodness is to be good? And that's why you get annoyed when you do good and people do you bad. Anybody like that? Everybody should be like that. You've been good to people and then they want to show you. God wants you to be good, and that's why I always do good to you. All the time. Praise the Lord. God answers prayers. Tell your neighbor, God answers prayers. And I said something that I want to say again. Learn to wait. Learn to be patient. If you cannot wait for God, you will be deceived into all manner of atrocities. You'll be deceived. Learn to wait. Learn to wait. Learn to wait. When you pray, God, when you pray, God heard. And he will do it. It will fix you up. It will answer you at the right time. That he is appointed the time that is best for you. And you're going to look back and you're going to say, blessed be the name of the Lord. But between here and there, you get a length to praise him and give him thanks. And not to just every day come back. I don't even know why God has not answered my prayer. No, you just rubbish your prayer. Because what you said is wrong. I don't know why God has not answered my prayer. No, he answered. You're waiting for delivery. You're waiting. And you're thankful to God because you know he won't fail you. You're giving him thanks because you know he won't fail you. I know what God has told me. I know what God wants me to do. I'm not there. I don't even think I've started yet. But I know that gradually something is happening. Anybody here, there has been things in your life that you felt, I don't know how this would ever happen. And just, oh, it just happened. Anybody? Anybody have such testimonies? Anybody here? You thought this would never happen? I don't know. This is going to happen maybe like 20 years time. Oh, I can't figure out it will happen. And then it happened. And then it happened. Because you prayed it sometimes and God heard. And God started putting things together and setting things up. But because of our finite understanding, we know little. Because of that, we just worry and run here and there. I want to break the door. You remember where we started from? I want to break the door. The persistence that you really want to do is persistence in praise and thanksgiving. That's real persistence. Lord, I thank you. So you remember our car issue? After praying for the car, you just keep on thanking God. Say, Lord, I thank you because I know he's coming. Lord, I give you praise because you've never failed me before. Lord, I know that this is also coming. You're looking for a job and you've prayed. And you've prayed enough. You will know when you've prayed enough. Instead of degenerating into saying, I don't even know why God has not answered my prayer, that's the time to praise God. Instead of you start thinking, I don't even know why it's taking too long and God is delaying, that's the time to praise God. Instead of you thinking, I'm tired now, that's the time to praise God. When you feel you've prayed enough, and instead of reversing your prayer and destroying your prayer and saying negative things that are not in line with the word of God, that is the time to do what? To praise God. Just for 2 minutes, I want people who can praise God. Hallelujah. Oh, come on. Anybody has ever prayed before? Anybody has ever prayed before? God has answered your prayer. God has answered your prayer. Now listen to this. We're no magicians. We're not going to say, oh, tomorrow, yes, suddenly, God, suddenly. No. God knows the best time for you. At the right time, it'll come true to you, for he will not fail. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. At the right time, he'll come to you. He heard when you pray. Don't get involved in all those atrocities and people telling you all manner of things. You can't pray now. You don't know how to do that. That's why this, you would, no. Listen to this. What is not right, make right. If you're living in sin or anything, you're opening the door. The serpent will come in and bite. That's not God who doesn't like you. You're the one causing problem for yourself. Seal it. Go get some cement and seal the blood and seal the place. And stop the serpent from coming in to bite. And if there's something you've already done and there's consequences on ground, they'll say, God, I don't think you don't really like me. That's why this is happening. Accept that this is the consequence of what I have done. But I thank God because he's taking me higher and taking me ahead of this. Because you see, the moment you begin to blame God for it, that's when you open the door for the enemy. God loves you so much. And if you want to keep those consequences out of your life, do what is right first time. And you say, but Pastor, how do I do first time what is right? You cannot depend on the grace of God to do what is right, to make the right decision, to be in line with the word of God. There is absolutely nothing your God cannot do.